The pancreas. When it comes to the pancreas and pathology, you divide it into exocrine and endocrine pathology. Here, our topic is endocrine pancreatic pathology. Our discussion first will walk us through enteroendocrine tumors, and by that we mean those tumors that we find in our pancreas that will then affect different parts of your enteric system. Let's begin. First, we'll take a look at MEN type 1, multiple endocrine neoplasia type 1. Its gene that you must know is MEN1. Hence, if you want, multiple endocrine neoplasia type 1, N. Autosomal dominant, the tumor suppressor gene has been lost. The three P's from MEN type 1 include the following. You want to go in alphabetical order, if it makes it easier for you. Pan, para, pit, I'll tell you what each one of those mean. The para would be hyperparathyroidism, resulting in increased calcium or hypercalcemia. The pan would be pancreatic outcell tumor, and we will be walking through this in great detail. You probably heard of or have heard of a gastrinoma known as Zollinger-Ellison syndrome, in which your patient is now suffering from recurrent refractory peptic ulcers and insulinoma, glucagonoma, somatostatinoma, a VIPoma. All of these are part of your pancreatic islet tumors. Whenever you think about pancreatic islet, most students tend to stop at gastrinoma and ZE. Please do not do that anymore. Quickly, if it's insulinoma, you should be thinking about your glucose levels being very, very low. Too much insulin. We'll be walking through that in great detail. That would be one of the common ones. Glucagonoma, the three D's. We have diabetes because of excess glucose, too much glucagon. Diarrhea. Dermatologic, and this is then referred to as being necrolytic migratory erythema, in which it may look like impetigo, where you have honey-crusted lesions on the sides of the mouth. The somatostatinoma, here you would have diabetes, diarrhea, and gallstones. And with VIPoma, we'll be using an acronym known as WDHA, water diarrhea, hypokalemia, and achlorhydria. The pit is pituitary adenoma. The most common pituitary adenoma or functioning type in which the hormone that's being released will in fact be prolactin. So it'll be a prolactinoma that we'll be looking at. Under MEN1, PAN, pancreatic islet cell tumor, para, hyperparathyroidism, hypercalcemia, pit, pituitary, you should be thinking about your pituitary adenoma. Thymic carcinoid, rare. What are we looking at here? Well, our topic first will take us into a beta islet cell tumor, so therefore this is an insulinoma. With insulinoma, first and foremost, please make sure that you know that it's a beta islet cell tumor. It's one of the most common pancreatic islet cell tumor. Could be part of your MEN type 1. With all this insulin that's being produced, how? Endogenously or exogenously? Obviously endogenously. The reason I bring that to your attention is because something that you want to be familiar with biochemically is the fact that if you're producing insulin endogenously, in vivo, in excess, along with insulin, you're also releasing what into circulation technically? Good. C-peptide. So you would expect to find high C-peptide levels in a patient with insulinoma. Isn't that interesting? Whereas if it's exogenous use of insulin, maybe you have an athlete in which he or she is trying to promote anabolism or increase muscle mass, then you would not find such high levels of C-peptide. Can be benign or malignant. Majority of these are benign. Keep that in mind. All other pancreatic islet cell tumors tend to be malignant, so that is a big deal. With all this insulin that's coming out endogenously as a C-peptide, focus upon that. And you have the Whipple triad. Now, instead of memorizing Whipple triad, use common sense so that you can figure out as to what's going on with your patient. First and foremost, with all this insulin, you can expect there to be hypoglycemia and blood glucose levels, which to keep it simple, should be approximately 100. Ha! Drops all the way down to 50 milligrams per deciliter. Measured at the time of symptom in which your patient here with a severe hypoglycemia may result in stupor, dizziness because of hypoglycemia. And the way that you relieve this, obviously, is going to be by giving this patient glucose. Now, this is relieving the hypoglycemia, obviously not treatment. A treatment is going in there and resecting the particular tumor. Keep in mind that whenever you do have an insulinoma or you present it as such, in your mind, you're thinking, what other endocrine organs might be affected? Could it be hypoparathyroidism? Could you find hypercalcemia in your patient? Could it be prolactinoma with the galacturia and maybe loss of libido? All part of MEN1. Let's continue with the pancreatic allosteal tumor. Insulinoma management may be difficult. Localization after biochemical workup. The imaging study, CT, MRI, octotod, endoscopic ultrasound with or without biopsy, so you can actually find it. First line of treatment is surgical resection. Must take it out in terms of final cure. Remember, though, with Whipple triad, things that you want to do in the meantime to make sure that you're managing your patient is that when there is severe hypoglycemia, that you're giving your patient, in fact, glucose. Do not forget that. Then the medical treatment may be needed to control hypoglycemia. That is of utmost importance. Diazoxide, octetide, verapamil, phenytoin, things that you want to keep in mind when you're dealing with a patient with insulinoma, where perhaps surgically was not able to properly manage or cure your patient.